Welcome, everyone. This is a story about a book, but it's more than just a story about a book. It's a story about something troubling and profound in some ways, which is captured in the phrase that I've proposed for both the book and also for tonight's title, The Eclipse of Equality. It's a summary statement about where I think we find ourselves in American politics, but not only American politics, but also in the political conflicts around the world. It's about a category of thinking. It's about an idea, if you will, a very broad idea called equality, which I think we've in some ways forgotten how to think well about. And that's what I'm going to try to present to you today, this idea. As I move forward, I should say that the ideas presented here are larger than any book could be, and certainly larger than any career could be. So there's something exploratory, tentative, and even playful about the ideas I'm going to present here. And you'll see that they are in some way still evolving. But nevertheless, I'll present it in the context of a specific project around this book that I've just published this year. So the book is about Meet the Press. So you see The Eclipse of Equality is the title. But when I present the book, you see there are sort of interesting challenges in making sense of it. There are typical reader expectations, which are, well, it's a dated television show. I don't even watch that thing, right? That's what I hear from a lot of people. I do, in fact. I watch it all the time. I've watched, in fact, all 3,500 of them, but that's a different story. if people do think, okay, well, I can see it's a relevant show, it's about politics, it's about American politics in particular, well, it's just a showcase of political theater, or maybe just talking heads and prattlers up there doing what they do, and I have more efficient ways of getting my news. I tweet today, of course, our president tweets here at the university. We all have ways of dealing with these issues, and we have much more efficient ways of approaching it. But I was interested in Meet the Press for a different reason. And the reason was, well, I'm a sociologist, as Peter said. I'm a statistician by training. This is a book which was written largely in a qualitative mode. It wasn't, there's no statistical work in this book. There are no tables and no significance tests. But whenever I would do the kind of work where I was looking at political polling data or I was looking at long-term trends, I would use Meet the Press and its sister shows. It wasn't about Meet the Press itself. I was interested in the Sunday shows more broadly, including Fox News Sunday and CNN's State of the Nation and Face the Nation, all these interesting array of shows. And the reason I was interested in them is because I found that what you can do there is you can test your ideas, which often are disconnected, that is, if they're ideas of the American people, against the insiders. And this is what I was, and this is what I had always done. And I thought, what if I'm here in DC, why don't I write a book about that? And it turned out one could do that. And so I did. And what I discovered when I started looking into this was that I decided there was that Meet the Press is in fact the custodian of the conventional wisdom, is one way I like to put it. You can say, well, what do they do on Meet the Press? One thing they do is they guard very jealously what it means to say things which make sense within the Beltway. And that's the only kind of ideas you're going to find there. You won't find a lot of the more radical, interesting ideas, the cutting-edge stuff that makes you excited. It doesn't make it, it's not there unless it's already made it into the mainstream. And therefore, it becomes a very interesting barometer, I'm going to say. And what you have there is also the evidence of the evolution of what I say the ruling ideas of the American century, this old phrase from the 30s. The idea is that Marx quipped that the ruling ideas are those of the ruling class, but in a less economistic vein, you find here these are the rulers in some sense. They're in contact with the rulers, and you see these ideas being presented. And also, I think what you find on Meet the Press, and this has to do with America and its role in the world, is you find a kind of global canary in the coal mine. There are things that are happening here, there are things that are happening in the United States, which are going to be significant for the rest of the world, if only because the United States plays such an outsized role. So there are all sorts of reasons why you might want to pay attention to Meet the Press, far beyond the idea that it's an important television show, as we see the movements of social power and difficult situations. So in tonight's talk, I'm going to move through four basic themes. I'm going to say a few words about the puzzle, which is, I think in some ways people say it's a very timely book, but whenever I've talked about the book, it turned out to be timely, and that's by design. It turns out that it's anchored in the structure of our protracted conflicts in the United States. I'm going to say a few words about the theory, which are really the conceptual categories through which I've tried to make sense of what's going on. The method itself, how did I do this? How did I move through these materials, this huge body of evidence? And then on to the story itself. So in a fairly rapid succession, so beware. Okay, so what is the timeliness of the book? Well, we of course are in a period of dysfunction. One of the chapters of the book is decoding dysfunction. And you see here a number of phrases that are just drawn from the headlines of the week. We're still in the shutdown as we speak. We don't exactly know why. Everyone seems to be befuddled, don't know what to do about it. Conflict seems to be getting worse. We're ungovernable. Well, in part, I think that has to do with the state of the political culture. And you can trace it back to its title sources. It's not simply the waves and the ripples, but to see the long-term trends. That's one of the things you see in a data series like this. And I think you can learn something interesting about how it is that we find our politicians so unable to deal with one another. Well, why is it happening? Is it just simply Republican civil disobedience? Here's Paul Krugman for the New York Times. The federal government is shut down. We're about to head at the debt ceiling with disastrous economic consequences, and no resolution is in sight. How did this happen? The main answer, which only the most pathologically balanced reporting can deny, is the radicalization of the Republican Party. Well, yes. But also, and this is, it's nice being in the business of studying conflict resolution or studying conflicts and their escalations, because you realize wherever you start this story, you can always tell a story like this one about the other side. And so civil disobedience didn't start with the Republican Party. It goes way back. And it wasn't organized always around the kinds of libertarian themes that we see on display downtown just recently, but it's had other sources. And the escalation has been moving forward for decades. And we're only starting to realize where it's headed. So this is part of the story. Well, another part of the story is the problem of economic inequality. Here's a famous, this has become famous now, as Piketty and Sayers are the authors, these are the economists. What you see here represented is what I call the parabola of pain. You've got the top income shares deviated from their average. So if you're above the line, this means that you have a larger than average share of the income. The blue line is the 0.01%. The red line is the famous 1%, and the greenish line is the top 10%. But what you see here is that in the teens and 20s, the rates were above their averages. They went down below throughout the period right after World War II into the 1980s, and they've recovered to their earlier pre-World War II rates, pre-depression rates. And in case you're curious, what you see here are to make the top 0.01%, you need around $3 million, and then $500,000, and about $130,000. So these are people who are doing quite well, and they're doing much better, as we've here reported quite a lot recently, than they once were. This is a context of suffering, and it's a context in which this eclipse of equality has taken place. But there's more to the puzzle as well. This is a photograph that you may not have seen. It's one of my favorite photographs from a photographer that we met in Madison, Wisconsin. Brad Pogatetz, and this was in preparation for the March on Washington event. SCAR, you may not know, the School for Conflict Analysis and Resolution, had the opportunity to host the reception for that 50th anniversary of the march, and we were able to present this material to Martin Luther King III, among others. But this is just a quote from a gentleman who's looking back on his experience, an older gentleman. He says, "I had hoped when I was young, a young man, that we'd see a lot of progress by now," said Mr. McDonald Cash, a resident of Columbia, Maryland, "but I think we're going backwards." There's a sense of going backwards, a sense of going backwards around issues of race, a sense of going backwards and the idea that perhaps, I love the picture because it's this idea of living the dream. And what does it mean to live the dream? Is it what we had expected it would be? And in some ways, I think it's not, and in part it has to do with what this phenomenon I call the eclipse of equality. And here's where the puzzle gets very interesting. So what you have here are what I call two inequalities beneath and within. So you've got a time series here of earnings, men and women, going back to the early 1970s, and there are many things to say about a graph like this. The first thing that we tend to say is that we see some injustice here. You see that the women's line is, the bottom line is climbing up to around 37,000 compared to the 48,000 for men. It is climbing, it's slow. We know that this is unjust. Why? Because men and women in the new economy are equally prepared or should be equally prepared to do well. And yet there are these differences. So we have a story of injustice, of abusive power. That is, abusive power of what kind? That's the interesting question. These are inequalities between the groups. What is left out of this is what I call the invisible inequality. That is all the variation about the lines here. You don't see anything around it. And what you have there is the within group inequality. What's interesting about the difference between and within group inequality is that the within group inequality, this is perhaps the thesis, the larger thesis of the book and of my perspective, is that we have few stories which are compelling that anchor this within group inequality in some kind of conception of injustice. We know it's unjust for men and women to have such differences. It doesn't make sense. We don't want it to be the case. And there's some kind of power which makes that so. And what is that? It's prejudice, stereotypes, bigotry of certain kinds, chauvinism. We know what that is. We can anchor it. It's anchored in the culture. The abusive power, if you will, and this is the way I'm going to characterize it, is a cultural force. It's in networks of cultural power, social power. But what about the other form? Well, it's chance. People worked hard. They were good. They were lucky. What have you? I don't know. They some did well. Some didn't do so well. And although we have stories to tell about within group inequality, we're not very good at it. None of us are very good at it. Even Paul Krugman, who's a lone voice crying in the wilderness, isn't very good at it. I mean, he's good at it, but in a sense, he can't reach the audience that you would have been able to reach quite easily if you were Paul Douglas back in the 1940s and 50s, who was a senator, a University of Chicago senator, who was an economist and a senator from Chicago. And he was able to tell economic stories that were extremely compelling and moved much more quickly through the political culture than we now see. So the distinction between within and between and group inequality is a distinction between what I'm going to call equality and tolerance. That's the distinction between inequality itself in material opportunities and so on, jobs and housing and opportunities, and intolerance. Because the difference between these two lines is a product of intolerance. It's a different form of social power than is what's driving the within group inequality. And then finally, I just want to hint at the fact, I remember I said that we don't do this all that well. We don't speak about abusive power in the economy all that well or compellingly. And what we see now is a Republican class card being increasingly played. So you see here Senator Ted Cruz. President Obama has granted a delay for giant corporations. Every big company in America has gotten a one-year delay. If Harry Reid shuts the government down, what he will be saying is American families don't get treated as well as we treat giant corporations. Giant corporations don't have to suffer, get to delay on the horns from Obamacare. But hardworking American families, he's going to insist that they suffer now. Look, people are frustrated with Washington, and the simplest reason is you've got politicians in both parties who aren't listening to the people and who are living by a different set of rules. The ruling class gets exempted. It's not working, and we're going to treat the American at least as well as we treat big business. Boy, that sounds like a Truman Democrat, right? And isn't it interesting? The puzzle is, why is it that this space is so open, so fertile, the terrain is so available for someone like a Cruz to step in with, as we know, no real, I would think it's fair to say, no real agenda to challenge the powers of the giant corporations he's speaking about. He might want to challenge certain practices of those giant corporations, but it's not at the core of what he'd like to see done. Well, what about the theory? How do we make sense of this? That's the puzzle. What kind of conceptual tools do we need? What I'm going to be talking about tonight is in a general terrain that you might see represented in these two books. George Lakoff, a few years ago, you might have heard of, wrote this book, Moral Politics, about frames and cognitive structures and the role that they played in the divide between the Democratic and Republican parties and conservatives and liberals and so on. And then on the other side, Frank Luntz, who's involved in the Republican Revolution the last time around in the 90s, is this book, Words That Work. These are the two sort of countervailing books that talk about the importance of language and how it anchors our interpretations and the frames that we put around an issue changes the way we see it. What I want to say is these are great books. They're very interesting and language matters, but I think that their problem is deeper than words, and it's more about frames. Well, what is the source then? What's my approach to this? What do I think is going on? It's at a deeper conceptual level. So I think that the source of deep-rooted conflict is anchored in violated expectations of social power. What I mean by that is that when you have expectations, you believe things are supposed to go a certain way. That is, like I said, about between group inequality on gender. And the idea is we have expectations that men and women ought to be doing the same. I mean, why are these gaps still there all these years later? Our expectations are violated. We have an interpretation, which is there's a form of injustice which is preventing that. We ought to direct our attentions to it. Well, so too with any interpretation of any political theory, frankly. What differs is the aspect, the form of social power that you're focused on. So here, let me move forward. So here's an obelisk from Karnak Temple. You might say, okay, what is this symbolic of? Well, it was symbolic of Ra, the sun god, and so on. It was symbolic of indigenous religious traditions, but it's also become symbolic of power itself, of sovereignty, of the idea of the state itself. And if you've traveled, most of you in this room, I assume, have, you'll find every capital has one of these. Right? And I think what it represents is the promise the state makes to you to protect you against certain kinds of violations. And those violations, as I'll say, are that you aren't going to be trapped on the street and beaten, or that you won't be invaded by a foreign force. And what we have here is, therefore, it's anchored in something which is, it's anchored in insecurity. If you didn't have insecurity, you wouldn't need the state. This is the famous Hobbes argument. And then the value, what I'm going to suggest, is the value that the political value derived from that, security itself, comes from the idea of what of an abusive social power that's been misused in the past. So security, in a way, the theory is that I'm suggesting to you and you can think about, is that our political values derive from our expectations, our violated expectations of social power, and therefore we need to hone in on what it is that the various forms of power are. Well, here's another great example of power violated. This is the French Revolution, which was against the king, which was for liberty, for freedom, anchored in the experience of unfreedom is an awkward phrase. I haven't found a good one. If you have a better one, you can suggest it. But in a sense, this is experience of lacking freedom. Well, here's Lenin, a famous painting of Lenin, and the critique there was a critique of inequality. Inequality was the problem. You see, it was the violation, and therefore it became the source, and it was also anchored in an idea of class power, not the power of the king, but the power of a class which was freed. And finally, we have the experience we've been talking about, which is intolerance, which is the dominant theme for the politics in this post-war period. And I like Gandhi as a representation of this, because I think it's one of the early clear forms of this argument, but it's anchored in the notion of intolerance and what kinds of forms of justice might be reactions to it. So again, we have here that the values themselves derive from the negative experience of abusive power. So that's the core of the theory, that if you don't have abusive power, you've got no story, you've got no justice story, you've got no justification, and it's very difficult to get a mass politics organized around an idea that has no theory of abusive power. Well, we've got the American vernacular. You probably saw where I was going. this is under construction, so obviously an old picture, but we have our own obelisk. We are the best state in the world. It's about 10 times the size of a normal obelisk. We've got our, if you take a trip around the tidal basin, we've got our great thinkers, Jefferson was involved in that original movement as well, standing for freedom, standing for equality. Roosevelt, going around the tidal basin, this is the fruit, if you will, of the four decades around the year 1900, the progressive era, a critique of concentrated economic power, put into a kind of a acceptable form with Franklin Roosevelt, brought on by the Depression. And he becomes the hero, once was thought of as a hero, widely recognized. And of course, the newest monument for Dr. Martin Luther King, who is among other things, a great critic of intolerance and the value, therefore, of acceptance in a beloved community. Well, so what has happened in this context? What's the basic story? So these, you see my idea of abusive power, values come out of this. We have to anchor our stories in these values for them to make sense. Well, what you'll see is you'll see anti-bureaucratic stories, anti-bigwig stories, and anti-bigot stories. There's always an anti in this sense, because you've got to have some conception of abuse, as I say, before you can have some conception of what you want. Well, here's my interpretation. So over the past 40, 70 years, let's say, you've had a general, let's say, falling away of the Roosevelt example. And in fact, I think that's the general story of my book, and I think it's the general story of our lives, is that anti-bigwig narrative, if you will, has become less and less compelling. And just so it's clear, You'll see the order in which this happens, the slow fade, the rise of the anti-bigot interpretation, and then complemented by the anti-bureaucrat narrative. So this is in fact the sequence in which I think this takes place, and it is a kind of a displacement, and this is the nature of the eclipse. What happens in this case is that each side then misrepresents the other. These are two stories which have a very compelling modern form. And what you see here is on the one side the Human Rights Campaign logo in the place of anti-bigotry, and it is an extremely powerful story. It's the new civil rights story that we have. And on the other side you see the Gadsden flag, you see the celebration of the revolution. And if we think about what is the dysfunction about and why is it not going to go away, why are we in trench warfare since about, I think, January of 2011 or so? Why have we been in this case? And it's because both sides truly believe the other side is unjust, uncivil, is not trustworthy, cannot be worked with, are violating core expectations of what it means to be an American democracy. And the side that is fighting for cultural rights, for respect, for inclusion, is being misrepresented as paternalist. And the side that's fighting for their conception of liberty, which is anchored in these anti-monarchical movements, is being presented as racist. So you've got the paternalist versus the racist. Nobody would want to be in either of those camps. They're both misrepresentations, and they anchor us in a situation in which it's very difficult to move forward. This is the argument that I try to make, and what you see missing from this is you don't have any compelling story about the injustice of inequality itself. Independent of intolerance, independent of state abuse of power, the fact that that we had these wildly soaring rates of inequality just seems to be unfortunate. It's just an unfortunate reality and a mechanistic outcome of what it means to be in a global economy. Which is probably frustrating. I won't go through this chart, it's been wrapped around here, but basically this is the theory that I've been working with, and I'm taking this now on a global stage. We're in fact, my research assistant is here in the audience. We're taking this argument, and we're going to be looking at protracted conflicts all around the world and looking at these various forms of abusive power and how it is that you see all grievances always and everywhere are represented or have elements of these abusive elements in them. So read the book if you're interested in that. So the method, how did I do this? How did I come to some of these conclusions? Meet the Press, as I said, for me is a barometer of the conventional wisdom. You've got pictures here of Ronald Reagan. That's his first appearance, 1966. You've got Larry Spivak, who's the original host. You've got Barack Obama giving an interview that he was very nervous about, as it seems, with Tim Russert. And then you've got Hillary Clinton with David Greger, who's the new host. So, as I've already made the case, but I think that what we see here is that unlike other data series, unlike other public opinion representations, what you see in Meet the Press is the ideas of that ruling class. How was it done? Luckily, one of the reasons I looked at Meet the Press is the same reason that it's the old Economist joke. You drop your keys over there, and you're looking for your keys here, and someone says, "Why are you looking here?" I say, "Well, here's where the light is," you know. In the sense that the Meet the Press exists. The data series goes back. There is an archive of the show going all the way back to June of 1945 when it was a radio program and laid down each week in regular format with a standard approach to collecting the data from my point of view and stored here in the Library of Congress, not the pretty building. This is how I actually watched all the old shows. This isn't the exact machine, but you had to use one of these old flatbed machines, and it's I'm not a historian by training, so intriguing to get involved in these kinds of archival methods. So here's the way that I think about represents. Meet the Press is a longitudinal collection of consistently prepared and high-quality focus groups and interviews that have been conducted with national leaders in steady intervals and with consistent management for nearly seven decades, from the end of World War II to the present time. If in 1945 one had set out to produce a prospective study, looking forward, of the evolution of the national policy conversation over the course of the coming American century, it would have been difficult to devise a better plan than this. So this is the sort of nerdy interpretation. This is the line that's most exciting to me, and I had to protect from being cut from the book, because this is, in fact, what's exciting about this book. This is what's exciting about the perspective, is it's an evidence-based point of view. It's anchored in concrete, high quality, consistently prepared focus groups and interviews. Very difficult to do that, And in sociology, if you were to do that with 50 such, you'd be happy, let alone 3,500. Okay, this is just quickly, this is what the data would look like. You've got Daniel Patrick Moynihan in December 65, you've got Ronald Reagan in 66, you've got what their title was, you've got the premise of the show. This is the way the data are presented. You can work through these kinds of ideas and you have this incredible array. The metaphor I was using for a long time when I was researching it is the ice core of the political climate. Right? Think about going to a glacier. You drill down, you've seen this done, you pull out your ice core, you can see how the climate has changed going back in history quite a long way. So too, you can do this. It's laid down in regular intervals, new snowpack every week in the same form, the same old boring way of doing things, right? And that's what's so interesting about it. It's a boring way of doing news, didn't used to be, but what that ends up being is great social science fodder. Yeah? And it tells you a story you can't learn any other way. Okay, so then what happens as a kind of sociological historian? How do I deal with this? Five principles. Take the data seriously. Look at who they had on the show at various intervals. They have an event, 9/11, who was on the show? You got an event, Sputnik, who was on the show? What did they talk about? How did they react? What kind of tone of voice? Were they confident? Were they shy? What were they doing? You have access to all that material and you get to see it too. That's the best thing about this is that it's television. You get to watch them. And by the way, that was the sell. I mean, we're so bored by television, we know what it's all about. But the sell was you get to see the person's face and how they react. And in a very familiar, right up close way, more close than I am to you, right? You get to see them. And that's very powerful. So what I do is I take the data seriously as if it's telling a story, because I think it is. And I don't bring extraneous material in. This is all meet the press references. You saw that the Ted that Cruz was as well. It's all meet the press references. Code every news premise. So what I had to do was go through all 3,500. It was 34 and change at the time, but it keeps growing every week, which becomes an issue as you get close to publication date. Code all the premises. That is why the show was happening. Why did they say they were doing it? Identify the major conversations and big ideas. This is the most difficult part. It took years. I spent 4 years doing very little other than this, and teaching and other things. But I mean, this was sort of sucked up all my time, trying to figure out what are the big ideas, what are the big conversations, and then search for thematic continuity within those conversations once identified, and turning points where things are different afterwards. But I've mentioned two already, right? These are in the foreign policy realm. Sputnik was one, and so too is 9/11. But those are turning points where you see afterward things seem different. So what happened after Sputnik? A lot of stuff about missiles. You know, missiles, all kind of missiles. I learned all kind of things about missiles that I never knew, right? So, and it's in some detail too. You had Wernher von Braun on there and so on. So look for those turning points, find areas of thematic continuity, check these again and again and make sure I've got them as close as I can to a story that I can tell, and then narrate those crises in particular. So pay special attention to the crises in between these moments when you're going to move to something new. That's the method, and that's what I've put forward. Now, the book itself and the way and the attitude that I had toward it, you can think of it as 20 short stories, because there are four big chapters, but each one has five pieces. That was the little device I used. And there are 20 short stories, really, about a certain episode in American history. Each one is chronological within. But really, in a sense, these are these little windows into an interesting period of American history using these data alone. And the four that I pull out, these are maybe what we might call the big ideas that I found. These are the conversations that I haggled with myself over. A world made safe for private enterprise. This is the foreign policy conversation. Taking aim at the New Deal. This is the evaporation of the Roosevelt alternative, right? The imagery of Roosevelt taking aim at the New Deal. Not entirely gone, still there, taking aim, trying to get after it, still comes back in the Affordable Care Act and so on. The redemption we dream of, which is eradicating racism, and this is one of the most compelling stories in the series, and I say one of the things that's most exciting about watching experiencing it the way I did was to meet Martin Luther King and others in that category for the first time, because you get to know what it's like before, the week before, and the week after, and you get to see how strange it is that they're there, and it really, you can feel it, and it's very interesting. And then four, the unmaking of the democratic class struggle. So the sub-themes that I presented for you today are defeating communism, let's put it this way. You've just won World War II, and you gotta figure out what to do with your new world you've inherited. What do? Well, we gotta defeat communism, okay? And then eventually that becomes anti-Americanism, which is any kind of challenge to American-style capitalism. You've gotta contain the welfare state because it seems to be running amok in many people's point of view. You gotta eradicate racism, it's causing trouble. In fact, it's causing trouble for the first category, It's difficult to defeat communists when you're racist toward most of the people who are attracted to communism. And you've got to crush the unions, which is related to point two, but you've got to crush the unions, as one person said, because they're the gravest problem facing the United States. Okay, so that's the things that you've got to do. And then fifth is gender. Now, there's no gender story in the book, and there's a good reason for it. I tried to write a gender chapter. Sandy's in the audience. I remember talking to her about this as we were developing this idea. And it turned out that from up to 2011, there were only 25 episodes that had a premise having anything to do with gender or abortion. Even. So there just was no national conversation about gender in the way that we think about conversations about race. There just wasn't a conversation. It's there, it's lurking about, but it's just beneath the surface. In fact, the show is invented by a woman, Martha Rountree. So there's a great gender story in Meet the Press, and it's always been, in a sense, led by great producers who are women. And there are great female guests and reporters. There's been a format change. But the gender story isn't in the content itself. We haven't had, I think, yet, and we're starting to see it since I published the book, a more interesting conversation about gender. So it's not in here. So here's the first story, defeating anti-Americanism. So these are the five, remember I told you there are these five pieces. Let me just advert to this and not move through it in any detail, but say, so the first chapter was, the first sub-chapter is about, let's say, if we think on the right, moving to the right is the idea is progressing, moving over time going down. So just work with me that way. So if you're moving in the right direction as you move down, the idea is progressing. So at the beginning, the idea is this maximum of freedom, and I'm going to introduce you to a character who articulates this, as the idea of defeating communism. It has to be done, and private enterprise has to be protected. Vietnam, what kinds of sacrifices? It's not just Vietnam, it's after Sputnik. Should we invest in education? Should we invest in the military? Should we dominate the world? Should we educate the world? What are we going to do? And you see fascinating conversations there that I can't get into tonight between the person, by the Sputnik episode, by the way, who appeared? The president of Harvard University, Nathan Pusey. So the idea, our reaction was to invest in education, interestingly enough. But the other reaction was to build better missiles. So, and it's an interesting thing. So you see that moving in a direction. Human rights and civil rights is the interesting, I'd say, globalization of the civil rights movement under Jimmy Carter and Andrew Young, his ambassador to the United Nations, moving away in a critical direction with respect to the idea of promoting, spreading American-style capitalism around the world, back on the victory trail with Reagan, and then finally with War on My Mind, where this is a quote from George Bush. I'm a president with war on my mind, and it seems that Obama also is trapped in that situation to some extent as well. We're trapped in a situation of war. Well, let me here's one of my favorite episodes. This is from February 19th, 1949. The guest was Eric Johnston. He was the former president of the United States Chamber of Commerce and now president of the Motion Picture Association of America. 1949, Motion Picture Association of America. Notice anything that happened back then? The Hollywood blacklist is what happened. This is the guy who comes up with the idea. He's anchoring the idea at the time. He claims that communism is gaining strength in the world and it's a dangerous thing. So this is the guy who, in a sense, is the leader through the imposition of the blacklist in Hollywood. Here's the sequence. It's at Tom Reynolds of the Chicago Sun-Times. What you're actually advocating is the use of American private dollars as a political weapon in the economic struggle that is going on around the world then. If you want to call it that, I think that is some part of the analysis of it. And then Arthur Sylvester, aren't you in effect, though, taking the risk out of risk capital? No, because business would have all the other ordinary business risks. What are they? The only thing I would want to insure them against is the extraordinary business risk of nationalization, confiscation, or destruction by war. The ordinary business risks are the same risks you run in this country. So what you see here is a deeply civil conception of how you ought to use American power. You ought to protect business from confiscation, nationalization, destruction by war, the crazy things that happen when you try to invest overseas. And what you have here is in a sense, a private enterprise interpretation of what democracy means. And I think American foreign policy has followed in this direction ever since. And when you hear people talking about no blood for oil, that's a cynical read on that. But ultimately, you're saying, look, this is a company, it's invested, it shouldn't face these extraordinary business risks, or else we're going to have a world that doesn't work all that well. So in a way, making the world safe for private enterprise, playing on the old phrase, is an idea that's been extremely successful, contested, but one that has moved in a conservative direction. Now about the welfare state, idea number two. We have movement toward what I would call unscrambling the omelet. So there's a famous phrase about Lenin that if you're going to make an omelet, you got to break a few eggs, right? The idea of a kind of a vicious way of organizing the economy around violence. Well, what we see is that movement toward what I'm going to call the edge of insanity. Not that that's Austin Goolsbee phrase, not mine. These are all people who said these things. So you've got a kind of a movement forward. Middle. This is the Kennedy era. Reagan really pushes the idea forward. Then you have Clinton move kind of back toward criticizing the old democratic ideology. Critical, it's saying the welfare state can be renewed. It can be a middle. Robert Reich says it can be a middle class politics. And then back under George Bush after 9/11. 9/11 changes other things. It changes this conversation about the welfare state as well. So in a sense, you've had another idea moving in a conservative direction throughout this period. The idea, and it's in fits and starts, but in particular under Ronald Reagan, you see it. The person I want to present today is John Tower. This is from June 18, 1961. He's the first Republican senator from Texas in 84 years. Remember, the Confederates were Democrats, right? That's something to remember. So it's hard to remember now in a way, but it's true. And this was the guy who led the charge back in Texas to the Republican Party, which was seen to be a very difficult thing to do. The news premise was that this is the Democratic Texas Senate seat goes to a Republican representative. That was newsworthy enough. That was the most important story of the week. Well, before I say this, John Tower, by the way, very conservative guy, and very important for Ronald Reagan, and Iran-Contra led the Tower Commission. So a very conservative guy, and also someone who I think articulated this critique of the welfare state. So what do we have him saying? So Robert Abernathy, NBC News Center, you've been described as a man whose political philosophy lies somewhere between that of William McKinley and Alfred the Great. You call yourself a conservative. And by the way, they didn't understand this. What do you mean a conservative? That doesn't make sense. As a former professor of government, can you give us a brief definition of what you mean by the word conservative? Of course, in the field of academic and political science, there are several accepted definitions of conservatism that apply in different cases. Our peculiar American variety of conservatism would, I think, go somewhat something like this. I believe that the conservative in the United States is one who wants to preserve our existing constitutional and legal system, one who wants to preserve our capitalist economy, one who wants to preserve the federal character of the republic. He is one who believes that, to perhaps simplify it a little bit, as Thomas Jefferson, that government is best which governs least. He opposes the centralization of too much power in the hands of the national government. He favors the devolution of power and responsibility on state and local government. He opposes high taxation and high spending. His concept is one that is basically libertarian with the accent on liberty. I love that. Rather than with the accent on equality. Okay, this is a theorist, if you will, of the eclipse of equality. How do you do it? How are you going to pull it off? Well, he shows the way. And it works. We're doing it now. This is the conservative philosophy. This is what you see on Capitol Hill now. And it's articulated in 61. It's a return of an old idea. It's not a new idea. They used to call this horse and buggy economics back in Truman era. But nevertheless, it's a return of an idea, and I think that it's moved in the direction over this period. Well, what about the racism story? This is one which I think is perhaps the most encouraging. As I say again, the progress of the idea moving to the right over time, moving down. You have the racists in the beginning who defend what they were doing as they were working for the progress of civilization. Then you have Martin Luther King and the classic era of the civil rights movement, what I think from 1960 to 1966. And by the way, that periodization makes sense if you take television seriously. The civil rights movement, of course, is much older than that. The March in Washington imagined in 41. It lasts much longer than that. But what's fascinating about Meet the Press is that if you see 1960 to 1966, that's one period. And after that, things are different. Before that, they're different. And after, they're different. Fascinating to see. So, and right after that, you have this introduction of this notion of a predatory criminal, the individual predatory criminal, an FBI-inspired notion that in fact, African Americans were predators and were uncivil and needed to be, in some sense, contained. This is this back period of the backlash. It's not the bust, it's us. It's a Jesse Jackson line. It's a period that I have, in a sense, slightly moving forward, but I call it the long 1970s. It's a period of really a kind of a stagnation of this conversation. It's not. It's kind of drudgery to watch this throughout. I mean, Jesse Jackson is entertaining to watch, but it's just a very difficult period that lasts up until about 1995. And then the final one is redemption on the cheap. It's a line about electing a black president. It was Colin Powell they were talking about. Well, that would be redemption on the cheap, in a sense, because you'd be getting an African-American, but you wouldn't be doing much about the situation, the structure of the situation. And so then the story ends up how once you actually move in that direction, it doesn't feel so cheap after all feels quite dear, and it's an interesting story to see. So this is the one of the three stories that moves, I'd say, unambiguously in the direction of the liberal, in the liberal direction. It moves and kind of fits and starts as well, but it is a transformation, what was called in 63, the revolution of 63. This is the story from 1966, which is the only time you had this kind of collection of civil rights leader ever on the show. You've got Martin Luther King, you've got Roy Wilkins, you've got Whitney Young, Floyd McKissick, Stokely Carmichael, and James Meredith, all on the show. Great show. It's like 90 minutes. The show used to be 30 minutes. This was a triple length show. Everyone knew how important this was. This is, and the context, by the way, is the plans for a march for housing rights in South Daring, Chicago. You'd had a big rally in Soldier Field. Chicago was going to become the nerve center of this new attempt to move the struggle north, because the racism in the north was seen to be even worse in some ways than in the south, even though it had been hidden. And this is the show, which is coming in a critical moment. There's going to be a march in South Daring, Chicago that day. And Martin Luther King, by the way, is in Chicago. He's not in D.C. It's a fascinating show, and there's so many reasons why it was that capture all the dynamics, and I think show why this is a turning point and what happens after. But what I think is most interesting to say briefly here is that what you see remember I talked about how Paul Krugman is talking about the civil disobedience of the Republican Party. The civil disobedience in the pursuit of liberty against intolerance begins here. This is where you see it. What we have is this, Martin Luther King is fascinating because he always brought his best philosophy to whatever he was. And you found it here in Meet the Press as well. He said, Richard Valeriani, Dr. King, to follow up Mr. Spivak's question, recent polls suggest that in terms of national reaction, demonstrations are now counterproductive. By continuing them, don't you run the risk of doing more harm than good? This was the general sentiment, by the way, and Harry Truman was attacking Martin Luther King as being silly in this period of time. People didn't get this idea. Again, I contend that we are not doing more harm than good in demonstrations because I think demonstrations serve the purpose of bringing the issues out in the open. I've never felt that demonstrations could actually solve the problem. They dramatize the existence of certain social ills that could easily be ignored if you did not have demonstrations. I think the initial reaction to demonstrations is always negative, and I'm still convinced that there is nothing more powerful to dramatize a social evil than the tramp, tramp of marching feet. There's the social movement idea in kernel. And there's other things you'll see in the Martin Luther King interviews. By the way, you can see those online already if you'd like. But I think that encapsulates this classic moment which never quite recovers the moral clarity that you had there. But it is the dominant story, I think, in many ways that we live with on the left today. Finally, this is briefly just to suggest this crushing the union story. The crushing the unions idea was, as I say, put it this way. If you were to tap into the 1945 series and watch listen to what they were talking about, the first, say, 15 episodes of Meet the Press, you'd think that American politics was about class conflict. I mean, that's what it seemed to be about. And this was really a heady set of concerns. Well, over the period of time, this starts to fade away. It escalates, and then it fades away. And it does this in a very particular way by demonizing the union leaders, in particular Jimmy Hoffa, and characterizing them as in a sense enemies or adversaries of democracy and civility itself, and this is done by the Kennedy administration. This is not only done by the Republican Party. And what you see is a steady movement with a little bit of a back turn when the public unions come online, when they're with a professional style that wasn't characteristic of the industrial unions, and a little bit of a steady movement this way, a little backtrack, and then finally a new push in the past few years. So this is another story of the four big stories. Three of them have moved in the direction of the conservative direction, and only one has moved in what I call liberal direction. And what you have here is the great episode by the governor of Wisconsin, Scott Walker. You may have, Occupy Wall Street became very famous around here, but of course the Wisconsin movements were much more exciting in many respects, and they had a substantive focus, which wasn't true of Occupy Wall Street, which is a kind of generic equality movement. But what you had in Wisconsin, which you had an organization around that old-fashioned concept of unions, of collective bargaining, of a mechanism of doing something. The man at the center of the storm is how he's described about collective bargaining in Wisconsin, embattled Republican Scott Walker. No longer embattled, by the way, very stably ensconced after having rejected, fought off a recall effort, and now touted as an important potential presidential candidate. So here's the interesting exchange with Scott Walker. Governor, if you're really serious about the state being broke, you have a deal that you could take it to get the contributions you need to solve the problem at hand. Why not separate that out from your views about collective bargaining? Scott Walker. But David, my point is repeatedly, as a former local government official, I know that collective bargaining has a cost. And when I'm cutting out more $1 billion from aid to local governments than is next to 2-year budget, I need to do what no other governor is doing across the country. They're all cutting. All but a handful are cutting. The difference is where we want to be unique in Wisconsin is we have to give those local governments the tools. Governor, how does this end? Well, I'm an optimist. I'm an eternal optimist. And he had good reason to be an optimist because the unions were disbanded. The public sector unions, which started in Wisconsin, collective bargaining for the public sector, and it started there and it ended there. So it was successful. He wanted to repeat Reagan's effort to crush the air traffic controllers union, and he did. It was exactly what he set out to do, and he did it by using the main elements of the American political storybook. He did it by capitalizing on what he knew was true, which was he lived in an era of the eclipse of equality. Those institutions which could only anchor their worldview in stories of the abusive power of the economic elite were weak. They're vulnerable. They're ripe for the picking. And he went out and he picked some low-hanging fruit. So conclusion. This is a line from John Stuart Mill. I teach John Stuart Mill. I think is a fantastic to get inside these conflicts around equality. And this is what I think is going on. I think the one way to see it. He's talking about how ideas die. He says, the fact, however, is that not only the grounds of the opinion are forgotten, this is when people aren't talking about stuff actively, not only the grounds of the opinion are forgotten in the absence of discussion, but too often the meaning of the opinion itself, the words which convey it cease to suggest ideas or suggest only a small portion of those they were originally employed to communicate. And this is my emphasis. Instead of a vivid conception and a living belief, there remain only a few phrases retained by rote, if any part. The shell and husk only of the meaning is retained, the finer essence being lost. The great chapter in human history which this fact occupies and fills cannot be too earnestly studied and meditated upon. That, for me, is the eclipse of equality. That is, the living belief, the idea, and it isn't the people, the phrases are all there, the working people, the American people, the rich, the fat cats, it's all there. Nobody connects it with powerful ideas. It doesn't animate the American Economics Association. It's not at the core of what people are doing when they think about actual economic policies. These are old-fashioned ideas. The exact same way laissez-faire ideas were old-fashioned in the 1950s. It's just that one side got organized, got focused, got intellectual, and they won. And that's the eclipse of equality. That's the situation in which we live now. What we see here, and this is a call out to one of my colleagues here at George Mason as well, you see the rebirth of a neoliberal movement, a power and intellectual ideas, working on what I'd call that Gadsden flag side of things. You see this book by Amity Schles about Coolidge, right? I mean, Coolidge is an interesting figure to celebrate. He's one of the last figures before the Great Depression leaves us with Franklin Roosevelt, helps you to see the dissipation. It's happening very powerfully, and this book sold very well. Probably deserves so, but it was sold very well. And you have and Tyler Cowen, who's one of my colleagues here at Mason, who provocatively suggests the average is over. In some ways, he and I agree exactly. The average is over. He just suggests it's a good thing, or at least it's nothing to be done about it. I mean, it's just the mechanisms of the market are doing what they do, and the idea of trying to do anything about it is just going to cause more trouble than it would help. So, I mean, the old Adam Smith argument. So there we are. The difference, I suppose, between us is not the objective analysis, but the idea that this is just the way things have to be. In fact, I see the social cultural history evolving in this direction. It's something that people actively contested and created. This is a world we made. It didn't just have to be this way. But the average, in some sense, is over. That's what the eclipse of equality means. So what about on the left? What are the reactions? This is, as they say, I had the pleasure of being the interim dean of the school for the summer. And you see me having a conversation with Martin Luther King III here and surreptitiously slipping my book in there. But you see, but the whole point, and this is what I said to Martin, and this is the idea is that, you know, the living truth on the left, if there is one, is in the civil rights community. That's the story that of the four, that's the one that has moved forward. And I don't just mean just the civil rights community. That's the most salient example, but also around issues around gender and sexuality, identity, ethnicity. These are the powerful moving forces. We know the villains here. We know the social forces that are moving us in the wrong direction here. And I think in a sense that if you are a person on the left, as the earlier slide was if you're a person on the right, If you're a person on the left, you have to recognize that this is the vehicle. This is the way things are going to move forward. And the interpretation of this is that we have to move on. If you are a person who is concerned about these issues and aren't content to say, well, the average is over there, we are, you have to move from bigots to bigwigs. It used to be the other way around, and this is the final thing I want to say. So William Julius Wilson, the famous sociologist, articulated in this series of books about race that if you wanted to have a progressive racial policy, you had to do it through class. You had to move to race through class, what's been called targeted universalism. Think of Social Security. It benefits everybody. Of course, it left out, as you can learn, it left out agricultural workers and farm work, and domestic workers, so there was a bias to it. But nevertheless, you could get to policies that would help African Americans disproportionately by having universalistic focus, because that would raise all boats, and because there were disproportional poverty rates and so on, it would, in elderly poverty rates, it would help African Americans, so too with any kind of class politics. That was the characteristic perspective of the 70s. I think, in fact, we're in the opposite situation. Let me explain this symbol. So in 2002 or 2003, I heard about the Human Rights Campaign, this sexuality advocacy organization. I thought, that sounds great. Seems like the new civil rights frontier. Let me join, right? So I got my publication material, and I got all the PR stuff, and I grabbed this. I had this little sticker, this little magnet, and I thought, okay, this is cool. I don't know what this means. Let me put it up on my refrigerator or whatever it was. And I put it up like that. And it stayed that way. I don't know, my wife stayed. I don't know how long we left it there. And then at some point, someone said, well, that's an equality sign. You know that? And I thought, oh, I didn't realize that. And by the way, I was a sociologist studying social stratification, occupational inequality, right? I mean, these are the things I was studying. But when I thought about inequality, what I was thinking about was the thing about material inequality. I wasn't thinking about intolerance. You see, that was the between group inequality I was talking about. Yes, it mattered. It structured things. It was a story that mattered. There was an interpretation. But for me, it wasn't what the focus on equality was, but it's what it means to us. It's, in fact, the way we see things. But what's important to recognize is it's entirely separable, not separate in any way, but separable from these other issues. You can have a sexually egalitarian society that's wildly unequal in material outcomes. Or on with respect to gender or race or any other set of concerns, you can eliminate, I mean, it won't happen likely, you can eliminate intolerance and still have inequality. They are orthogonal, they're at right angles. And I think that's the lesson here. It's a kind of a strange thing that happened to me, but nevertheless, it illustrates the analytic problem that we now face. Thank you very much.